Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. I'm Nick Barber. Coming up on this week's show, we have a car you can test drive over the internet, Google Street View is in trouble again, and the MIT Media Lab celebrates 25 years. We'll start this week with Apple and the new MacBook Airs the company unveiled on Wednesday. At their thinnest point, they're about a tenth of an inch, and that's partly due to what Apple's omitted from the new laptops.
As interesting as what it's got is what it doesn't have. There is no optical drive, and there is no hard drive. We have gone to flash storage, complete solid-state storage.
Storage ranges from 64 to 256 gigabytes, and screen sizes are either 13.3 or 11.6 inches. The 11.6-inch MacBook Air starts at $1,000 for a unit with 64 gigs of storage and a 1.4 gigahertz Core 2 Duo processor. The high-end 13.3-inch Air goes for $1,600, and they're all on sale now. Microsoft's chief software architect, Ray Ozzie, has announced plans to step down. He's planning to retire from the company and has no immediate plans following his departure, CEO Steve Ballmer said in a memo to employees. Ballmer was vague about when exactly Ozzie will leave, saying he'll remain for a while. Ozzie joined Microsoft in 2005, and at the time, he was best known for being one of the creators of Lotus Notes. Starbucks and Yahoo rolled out the Starbucks Digital Network on Wednesday to 6,800 stores across the U.S. The information portal includes free online access to content, including news stories that wouldn't normally be free. The network has six content channels ranging from news to business and careers. Yahoo built the Starbucks Digital Network and will manage and host it. The company will provide content from its sports, finance, and news sites. Typically, you test drive a car before you buy it, but technology is catching up with that, allowing you to take a car for a test drive online. From November 1st to November 10th, Mitsubishi is offering U.S. drivers a chance to take its Outlander Sport for a test drive online, but it's not a computer simulation. The company's rigged one of the vehicles with a robotic control system so it can be remotely controlled via the internet. Cameras inside the car will send back live images to drivers. Mitsubishi says that participants will be able to enjoy the feeling of being in the driver's seat, even though they might be thousands of miles away from the closed course where the test drives will take place. The cars will use video cameras, radar, and lasers to see other cars, but they'll always have a driver ready to take over should something go wrong. We'll take you around the world in this week's News in Brief, starting in Asia, where Skype is coming to Japanese cell phones. Next month, two cell phones with Skype will go on sale, and the service will be rolled out to other Android and Brew-based handsets in 2011. Skipping over to Europe, Spain is preparing to fine Google over infractions against local data protection laws when it collected Wi-Fi data as part of its Street View service. Google apologized, saying that they were profoundly sorry for having mistakenly collected payload data in Spain. And coming back here to the U.S., Clearwire is launching its 4G WiMAX network in New York, San Francisco, and Los Angeles by the end of the year. The service offers speeds similar to Wi-Fi, but without the short-range limitations. It's already available in 56 markets across the country. We have a special report this week on the role smartphones play for the Society of the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals in Taiwan. They use smartphones in a number of ways to amplify their impact on the island. They use GPS and Google Maps to go to rescues in remote locations. Video from their handsets can be used as evidence during their investigations or to show donors how their money's being used. They'll also post cell phone photos to their Facebook page and other sites to find homes for stranded animals. One time they attached a flashlight to a smartphone and lowered it into a building's air duct to find a lost kitten. An echo in the pipe made it sound like the kitten was close by, but it was actually two floors down. Without the video, they might have wasted hours searching. More recently, they used their smartphones to collect video testimony in a small town north of Taipei, where a farmer was setting wire traps that were injuring local dogs. For more information, log on to spca.org.tw, and you can also find our full report on YouTube. Staying with mobile phones, we had the chance to catch up with one of the companies on the forefront of user interface design, Sweden's The Astonishing Tribe. Here's what its CTO had to say about 3D interfaces.
I think we usually see 3D from three different angles, you could say. It's the first and most obvious is obviously 3D as a sort of visual differentiating factor, just a gimmick or something that sort of creates a signature kind of feeling to the user experience. But that's a quite shallow approach. The other thing is really when you use 3D as a way to being able to add more information to the UI. The third is really when you use 3D as a way to create more natural interaction, sort of creating 3D metaphors of the real world. One thing that we look quite a lot at is how you create a seamless transition between a 2D environment, a 2D UI environment, and a full 3D environment.
Buildings spring to life from this map when the phone is tilted. Combined with data from a compass, it allows the map to transform into a potentially useful navigation aid as you walk around a city. The MIT Media Lab celebrated its 25th anniversary this week. From the lab, we've seen inventions like the OLPC, robotic prosthetics, and electronic ink. I caught up with one of the lab's researchers who's developing a mouseless mouse. It allows users all the benefits of an existing mouse, including left and right clicking.
Which is very cheap, like $10 hardware that we are using. There's a laser, infrared laser, and a camera, which is actually tracking everything, but everything is part of the laptop itself. So, and then software is doing all the magic in this case, that understanding the gestures that you're doing with your hand.
The software tracks the locations of the fingertips and then interprets movements and clicks. Mystery has been working on the project for about a month and wants to eventually incorporate Z-axis recognition so that you'll be able to move your hand up and down to control certain aspects of computing. Well, that's our show for this week. Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. To find out what's coming up on every week's show, be sure to follow us on Facebook and Twitter. As we head out this week, we'll leave you with some shots from the Media Lab's 25th anniversary. I'm Nick Barber, and for all of us here at the IDG News Service, thanks for watching. We hope to see you next week.